power our workforce to drive financial sustainability. The four presenters today will be myself. So I'm the Associate Director of Finance at NorthMed. We've got Howard, Davinda and Rosina, who are also all the finance managers and who have probably done the hard work in sort of developing the training and development that we've been doing at our trust. And we've got a quote there saying that if you always do what you've always done, you always get what you've got. And that's where we sort of learned that actually we need to do something differently to be able to transform the way our workforce was operating and get the best out of it. So during this presentation, we're going to take you on a journey of what we did at North Middlesex and how we wanted to improve the way we empowered our workforce. And I will hand it over to Howa to start off. Thanks, everyone.
Hello, everyone. As Paris has mentioned, I'm one of the finance managers for the surgery division. So Paris, the slide's not.
Oh, it's not. It should move to the next one.
Okay. yes. So sorry. Yes. So I'm Howard Musaji, the finance manager for the surgery division, but I'm also the FSD lead for the trust. So I'm going to go through the improvement, the training and development improvement journey that we went on. This slide kind of summarizes our journey, but it's also a kind of overview of our presentation. So it all kind of started about 18 months ago when finance were asking, we were asking the question, are we getting the basics right? So that then started this journey. So it all started with doing a realistic assessment of where we were. That assessment then identified the various gaps that there were and also then, highlighted the areas for improvement. Then we went on to brainstorming in terms of what we could do. But more importantly, why? That was a crucial question for us. And then what we actually did do and what else are we doing? So in terms of this presentation, I'm going to talk about the assessment tool that we used. I'm going to go through the kind of areas that were identified for improvement. And then I'm just going to try and answer the question why we were doing it. My colleagues will then go through what we actually did do and what else we are doing. Paris, next slide. Thanks. So as I said, it all kind of started about 18 months ago when we were, the finance department was asking whether the trust finances were sustainable for the longer term. So we decided to use, the finance department decided to use the HFMA's Improving NHS Financial Sustainability Toolkit. I don't know, is anybody familiar with this toolkit? Put your hands up if you are, if you've come across it. I'm assuming, I don't know what to assume. Oh, yes. Yes. So that's good. So some of you are kind of aware of this toolkit. So this is, so what happened was the finance director at the time decided to put together bi-monthly meetings to go over this toolkit. And because I was the FSD lead, I was asked to take part and assess the training and development aspect of this toolkit. This toolkit was really helpful in kind of two areas, really. The first was that it was an evidence-based toolkit. And also the second reason why it was really helpful, it quickly highlighted the areas for further work. So that's why we found that really useful. And it was giving us the where are we now answer. So in terms of this toolkit, there were two aspects to it. If you're familiar with the toolkit, there was an initial assessment, which was a high level assessment of the financial arrangements within the organization. And then there was the detailed checklist. Next slide, Paris, please. This is where I came into it in terms of the detailed checklist. So the detailed checklist covered 8 areas. So it covered areas such as budget setting, forecasting, board reporting, and training and development. And within these sections, there were statements. So, and you had to score yourself against these statements. So 1 was poor, 5 was excellent. The important thing about this was that whatever scoring you were given, you had to evidence base it. So you couldn't kind of score yourselves five for everything unless you were able to evidence that. So actually you were having to be really honest and transparent about where, and realistic about where you were, what you were doing and what you weren't doing. So section eight is where I kind of got involved in the culture, training and development section. There were eight statements here. So in terms of these statements, this is an example of some of the statements there. So in terms of these statements, this kind of scoring, when we first started this, my understanding of training and development within the trust, I thought adequate in terms of of my own kind of view of how we were delivering training and development. But the scoring, when we scored it, we were getting twos and threes in most areas. And as you can see, the questions that we were kind of asked, the statements that were being made, they were very, very specific. So, for instance, budget managers, do they have clear instructions on what actions they need to take in managing any overspends? Is there evidence that the tone from the top is demonstrated? So it's very specific. And then, but being so specific, it also kind of highlighted where you needed to go in and make your improvements. Now, before we go on to the improvements, in terms of the training and development, in terms of the budget manager training that we were actually providing, I was quite close to that. And the way that was running before we made all these improvements was that if there was lots of noise about lack of kind of finance training, we then decided to kind of run a training course. But the problem was that if you wanted to book training rooms, you had to give 3 months notice to the HR department to book the room. So room availability became an issue. There was no kind of formal communication that the courses were actually being run. So when we did run the courses, there was very little kind of uptake. I actually remember running a course where only one of my budget managers turned up, and that was quite demoralising. So from that perspective, I could see why we were kind of scoring twos and threes here. Paris, did you want to move to the next one? So when I saw what the kind of improvements that we needed to make, I really was not surprised. So it was saying that our training provision was inconsistent. It was. The training was inaccessible to non-finance specialists. Training courses were poorly attended. Training provision was ad hoc. And just as I kind of said, that's exactly how it was. But it also kind of gave us other information in terms of information on SFIs were not included in our starter onboarding packs. You know, we hadn't kind of realised that that was really important too. And there was an unclear tone from the top around the financial sustainability agenda. So that's the areas for improvement. So now if we, next slide, please. So why was making training and development improvements important to us? Okay, because we realised earlier on that our financial sustainability strategy could only be fully embedded if we got buy-in from the organisation, and in particular from our clinical and operational colleagues. So that's why it was really important. So as this statement will say, so our operational and clinical staff routinely make decisions that carry financial implications, which, if managed effectively, can significantly impact our trust financial health. And lastly, but and quite importantly, and ultimately lead to improved patient outcomes. Now, this, our understanding of why it was important, was resonated in a joint statement that was issued in 2009 by various organisations. Paris, do you want to put? So this joint statement was sent out in 2009, and it was on behalf of the HFMA, the Royal College of Nursing, NHS Innovation and Improvement, so various kind of organisations. Now, there are some important points that were made in the statement, and that kind of resonated with what we were saying. So the next slide, please. So the statement was about clinicians and finance and improving patient care. And as it says here, these are some of the kind of, you know, points that were made. It's ultimately it's clinicians who are responsible for the way services are delivered to individual patients. And it is they who commit the necessary resources. And if they have an understanding, the tools and the ability to manage resources effectively, they can then use them well to the benefit of patients. And as we all know, and it's very, very clear, it's not sufficient for finance skills to reside only within the finance department. That's very clear from all my years of experience. And then the last bit is about how good use of resources will contribute to better service provision, which is ultimately our kind of message in terms of our training and development programme. Are there any questions, or do we leave them to the end? Or
let's leave the questions to the end, because thanks.
All right, I'm going to hand you over to my colleague Devinda, who's going to go through some other aspects. Thank you.
Thank you, Hava. So good afternoon, everybody. My name is Devinda Birdie. I'm one of the finance managers at North Middlesex Hospital. Look after corporate services, estates and facilities. So as Hava mentioned, what did we do really to engage with our budget holders, our stakeholders, to make this a more kind of meaningful exercise? And so they could then fully understand their budgets, understand the training that we could introduce to them. So the first thing we did was we actually we updated our intranet. So this really helped to improve. It was out of date. We identified our structure, finance structure, and who's the first port of call. So we transformed and updated the current state of play. And by this, it was by four enterprising and bold moves, which I will kind of discuss in the next slides. Thank you, Paris. So as you can see, we introduced the structure. We showed pictures because everybody's familiar with us, but they don't actually always know what we all do. And so we added these slides to the intranet. And this was about half an hour exercise before all this could be done. However, I had to actually have training for this with our communications team. So that really helped a lot. And in here, as you can see, there's a structure there that tells you who to contact for counter fraud, payroll, procurement, and all our SFI, standing financial instructions, are there for everybody to view and adhere to. The most important slide we added was the financial training, which is on the right-hand side. This was gave access to our budget holders, how they could access through our in-house training system, which is the Phoenix management system, how they could book themselves onto these three-hour sessions. And as you can see, there's a sample there on the 26th and 23rd of September. And so they can sign up. I think there's about 22 we can actually get on board. So it's a face-to-face three-hour session led by one of the FMs, myself, Hava or Rosina. And we do also ask some of the other teams. So it's good experience for our deputy finance managers to come on board as well. Thank you, Paris. Next slide. And further in that intranet, we added bite-sized HFMA, bite-sized courses people can attend, useful courses relevant to their kind of the occupation they're working in, the area they're working in. This is for budget holders, DDO, senior managers and divisional finance managers. This is an opportunity to engage in, and also offers CPD hours, 3 hours up to a maximum of 6 hours. And so there's also other information available on the HFMA website, really useful links. On the right-hand side, as you can see, we also added other financial training resources, including how money flows in the NHS, really important, how a workshop, and also how procurement, which we're going to come to later on, how we can actually order POs, and what the whole system is really, what the whole procedures are for that, instructions. And lately, we've also added a training pack for capital, led by our capital team, what the capital program is, having kind of what the process is to kind of delve into the capital program, and what case you have to put forward in terms of a business case for this as well. Thank you, Paris. So once we'd updated the internet, we wanted to go over to structured training modules, as I mentioned earlier on. It's a three-hour session where our budget holders can engage and learn about finance, what everything is done in finance. So this was here is a, so I'm going to just ask for next slide, please. Simple extract. We did a 45-minute exercise on this module. And this involved setting up a day case, as you can see in the sample there, setting up a whole ward unit and also costing the ward for the rotor. And there's a number of questions on the side. So they could either work in groups or individually, and then we gave them 45 minutes. So it was really, it really encapsulated whether what the theory we've talked about in the program is actually, you know, being understood. And this was really, later on my colleague will talk about the feedback as a result of this. Thank you, Paris. So some of the topics we discussed, we talked about in the training exercise, there's about a dozen topics there, as you can see. I'm not going to go through all of them. For instance, first thing we talked about, what is a budget? We discussed and expanded on what a budget is, how it's put together, what are the plan for the trust is, and our five-year long-term plan we brought together, and how the funding streams come from, engagement with our commissioners, our main commissioners. And so just to let them know, this is the limit we have, this is our cash envelope, and just ensure that they do operate within the cash envelope. And so there's not limited fund resources, there it is limited. Secondly, the other thing I'll discuss, we looked at our ClickView reports. Now, ClickView is our online budget holder reports available to our stakeholders, our budget holders, to view their reports, their budgets, management account, budget statements. And then we actually talk them through this, what makes up the budget statements, column by column, for instance, the annual budget, year-to-date budget, and in-month. So just to give them an idea of control of their budgets and expenditure, how it's all put together. We also talked about, we looked at the general ledger, how it's put together. It's, sometimes they just see a figure, we say, well, there's lots of feeders that make up your figure that you see on your reports, you know, accounts payable, accounts receivable, payroll, etc. And finally, I mentioned earlier on, we also did a little small topical quiz on the distinctions and similarities between revenue expenditure, capital expenditure, and charitable funds. So that, that had brought some interesting results for us. Thank you, Paris. Thanks. Yeah, if we could move on. Thank you. Yeah, so the next thing we did, the third item, our CFO, Bimal Patel, actually wrote some articles in our trust newsletters to engage with our stakeholders and budget holders to how they can build, how they can help us build financial sustainability for the future. And in this particular article, Bimal mentioned our capital program. So we actually received £23.9 million. And this then helped us build up the multi-storey car park, which we have at the moment, and also the day surgery unit. Secondly, Bimal mentioned the ERF as well. So how the funding streams for that helps us with us post-COVID to catch up on all our waiting lists. And there was a number of articles as well for this. So thank you. Thank you, Paris. So the other thing we do, we have a weekly team brief with our chief executive officer. I think it's lunchtime every Thursday. We actually took over this for one particular week, and led by Bimal and the SMT team, we engaged with the budget holders, told them all about finance, and we talked about the capital program, how efficiencies are put together. We had a session led by the PMO team about what is an efficiency, you know, why we have to report on it, our NCL feedback and priority. I think it was about £15 million at the time. You know, the reason, how we identify, how we go about identifying and sourcing the savings targets. Thank you, Paris. So that's the four items we actually put together. And I just wanted to highlight, that was the four stages. These were the plans we put together, collaborated on, in order to make sure all our stakeholders were more engaged, focused, adhere to trust policies, and also governance. So they also make them more accountable and responsibilities for their respective budget portfolio, in order to foster a culture of financial stewardship. Thank you. I'll now hand over to Rosina. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Rosina Malik, and I am the finance manager for Women, Children and Cancer Division. Now, one of the key things that we do is after we provide the budget holder training, we ask for some feedback. So here are a few of the comments and feedbacks that we have received. Things such as finance made more sense, which I think reflects the value in being able to take time out from your busy schedule and attend a focused face-to-face classroom-based training session. Comments such as it being interactive and engaging, because we do the practical sessions, it kind of just brings things a lot more closer to home. So we've received so far, in the most part, a lot of really positive feedback, and it's really, really good to get these kind of comments, because then it makes us realize that we are, on the correct path with this. And also, if we do receive some constructive criticism, we're very, very open to that, because of course we want to tailor and improve our training session, continuously. Next slide, please. So here is an example of one of the kind of like the full feedback that we have received from Dr. Roberts. To paraphrase what he's saying here, he's saying that, he has been a budget holder for a while, but there are knowledge gaps within his kind of finance knowledge. So by attending the budget holder training session, he was able to kind of like pick up on things that he otherwise didn't know that he didn't know. But so he really liked that. And once he had more information, things kind of made more sense, better sense. We as finance people sometimes use finance jargon, which is not really accessible or maybe confusing towards operational or clinical members of staff. So when we're providing these training sessions, what's really good is that it allows people a space to ask those kind of questions and clarify any kind of issues of that sort. So yes, and he also found the practical sessions very, very helpful. That's great. Next session. Next slide, please. So here is a comment by a quote from the American writer Mark Twain. Continuous improvement is better than delayed perfection. And I guess, after winning the Havelock Award, we haven't been complacent. We have, if anything, we have probably become more motivated and more proactive in terms of creating better training sessions for staff members. One of the things that we did was to create this interactive video about the PO system, which we'll talk a bit more in detail about in a second. And then also to touch on Steel with Pride. You go out there, you look at other resources available from for example, One NHS Finance, and kind of bring it to your trust and share it with the staff members at your trust. Next session, please. So this is one of the things that we have done in recent times. What we've done is we've created an interactive video session. So From within my division, I was receiving quite a few complaints around the whole procurement process. People find it confusing. People didn't realise where certain holdups were. And to be honest, it felt like actually staff members just didn't really see the end-to-end kind of processes, the step-by-step process. So what I initially did was I created a power pack presentation, but then what we discovered and what we chanced upon is the fact that someone within our finance department had this brilliant kind of like graphic design skills to create like videos and animation, and what he did was he helped to kind of like bring my present PowerPoint presentation alive, and he created this this animation video. So we'll show you a minute or two of this, but But what this has overall done is that it has created a step-by-step process from beginning to the end. So from the point where a staff member identifies a need to purchase something to raising requisitions or getting the POs authorized, and you know, what is a waiver, when is it required, and who authorizes things at what point, and then you know, up until the end point of when the invoices are actually authorized by our accounts payable team. So now what we'll do is we're just going to show you about a minute or so of the video. But if you wanted to see, if you wanted to kind of access the whole entire video, do let me know, and we'll take that request forward. So this is a full 5-minute video, and you know, if anyone is interested, we're you know, happy to share this. But what we realized, the best thing about this is the fact that this video is available on our intranet site for any of our budget holders at any point that they need to. You know, if for example, if it's a new budget holder and they didn't realize what the process was, or if it's the case that they wanted a refresher because, you know, they kind of had kind of maybe forgotten what to do next or what the process was again. This allows people to access this video as and when they need to, and it's you know, available all the time. Next slide, please. So this is another thing that what we've done. This ethos, formal management speak around this is deal with pride, but I prefer the terminology share with pride. And what this is that overall we are an NHS family and we're all doing things. So instead of working in silo, you know, why don't we share? My work colleague, Hawa, she was on the One Finance website. She came across this budget holder training workshop by Claire Fox from Lewisham and Greenwich Trust. And basically in that video, they covered things that we otherwise didn't have in ours. So instead of reinventing the wheel, Hawa kind of contacted Claire Fox of our Microsoft Teams and was like, do you mind if we use aspects of your presentation within our trust? Because we find it very, very helpful. And, it, you know, it would be a great help to us. Claire, you know, was great. She was extremely like collaborative and cooperative. And she said, yes, by all means, use it. And so this was great because, you know, this kind of collaboration work across all NHS hospital is great because a lesser or a larger extent, you know, we all face the same challenges. So, and we work under the same finance regime. So all these principles, for the most part, applies to all of us. So this was a great thing to do. So we're just going to show a little bit of snippet of this video right now. So this kind of training is really, really important. Way back when, you know, NHS Trust used to operate under a block contract, then it came on to payments by results. And then what PLICS and SLR does is that they kind of identify, you know, they look at all our different services and see whether they are, you know, operating at a loss or not from the tariffs that we charge or ask for from the commissioners. So this is really, really important. And, you know, this is some of the more valuable work that takes place behind the scenes that may not be visible to the ops team or to the clinical team. But, you know, we, in terms of financial sustainability, this gives us a lot of transparency with regards to our finances. So again, you know, for this kind of, if you would like to access this video, if you go into One NHS Finance, you'll be able to access it. That's my bit. Thank you.
Thanks, Azina. I mean, we've been quite speedily going through this. We could play some more of the videos if anyone else wants to watch more of it. But I've sent some of the links on the chat, so feel free to go on to those as well if you wanted to see a bit more of what we've done. One of the things which we just wanted to share at sort of the end of the presentation before we talk, sort of take questions, answers, is what's the three key takeaways that you want to take from this presentation? So the first thing is how I mentioned about the toolkit that we use. This is the HFMA getting the basics right. And you have, if you answer this honestly, you'll get the most out of this tool because it really means that you have to provide evidence of what you're scoring. It's not one that you want to say 5-2 everywhere and then think that you can just fob it off. It's one where you've got to find the evidence to show why you are 5. Why can you evidence that you're doing these factors? How can you show that the tone from the top is showcased to everyone across the organization? So that's one of the elements that you need to be really honest with yourself about when you do that assessment. I think most organizations should have done it, but if not, I think it's a good one to use just to see where you are. And then I guess the question is where do you want to be? What are the areas in your organization that you feel are the sort of, you know, gaps? And as sort of, you know, Devinda sort of went through saying, actually our budget holder training that we were doing before was sort of done on an ad hoc basis. It meant that we couldn't really book a training room because we had to do something 3 months in advance. And there was all these other complications. And therefore we knew where we wanted to be. We wanted to create these structured training modules that were accessible to everyone, that can be booked online, that were kind of like, even now we're trying to make sure it's enforced so that all budget holders make sure they attend these courses when they join the trust or have been at the trust for a certain period of time, just to give that sort of refresher sort of aspect. So create a plan of where you want to be and what does your organization need. Every organization will be different and have different challenges. And this is where, you know, you can tailor it to your own organization. There'll be some trusts trying to say, actually, what does elective recovery for ERF mean, elective recovery fund mean, and how can the organization drive extra benefits for that? Some might be around the procurement angle and seeing how requisitions are challenges to the organization, how we can make it more simpler. And then lastly, I think this presentation hopefully helps, is don't be afraid of stepping outside of your comfort zone and, you know, speak to others and especially utilize the One NHS Finance network, because I'm sure if you thought about something, someone's probably created it, and therefore, you know, it's not about trying to recreate the wheel. It's about stealing with pride, or as Mizlina said, share with pride. Material already created. And as you know, this will help. Anything you've seen on this presentation, we're welcome for you to share with your colleagues. And I think Charlie will share this presentation out at the end. But it's definitely something that we probably don't leverage enough of in the NHS, is how much material everyone produces and how we're such a big organization. If we kind of took what everyone did really well at, we'll have so much documentation, training, development for each of our organizations that I think could be quite powerful. But we're on that journey. We're on that sharing journey as well. And I think, you know, watch the years to come, essentially. I think we've finished our presentation. So I'm going to stop sharing now, if I can figure it out. But we welcome sort of questions. I think I've tried to answer some of the questions in the chat. Some of them were about the technology we used to create the videos, which was it's a bit harder to do because it was created by someone in our team, so who creates videos in his spare time. So I can't say that we're quite fortunate to have that knowledge. But I think, again, what we had done, we had created a PowerPoint presentation on it, as Vizina sort of mentioned, and it's something that we had created at least a framework for it. We're just fortunate enough that we have someone luckily in our team who's able to create into a video to get that added input. impact. But, you know, that was one of the videos we created. You saw Lewis and Gravesham had done another video about SLR and some of the aspects in their team. So again, it's something about, maybe it's not about recreating those sort of videos, but seeing what material is out there and how you can sign those people to the right places. I don't mind, sort of, should we do a hands up approach? I think that's probably the most sensible and logical way of doing things. If anyone's got any questions, please. Sang Tong.
Thank you. So my question is really, so you've done a lot of the MPO stuff, but then where was the sort of the procurement team in sort of this scenario? So we're relying on, we've got obviously an SLA with them. They're supposed to, you know, teach us how to, on a monthly basis, how to do POs, raise them, because we see them stuff. We haven't had that. We're doing that separately. But I mean, our finance director said, actually, that's their job. Let's not do, you know, I mean, I think temporary, we're going to have to put something in because we've been saying that for the last 6 months. But still, I mean, have you guys get training for them, or is this just because of their lack of training, that's why you've done this?
I'll bring Vizina in. Yeah.
So basically, the procurement team, you know, I collaborated with them when I was pulling together the material. I spoke to our accounts payable team, and I spoke to our systems team, and I spoke to our procurement team. And what our procurement team said was that, listen, Rosina, if you go onto our intranet, onto the procurement site, there's a lot of information there. So when you look at the information there, though, you know, it's all written down and it's all great, but it's all also very, very detailed. And I think what I wanted to do was create a presentation, which, you know, by luck turned into an animation, because I wanted there to be kind of like a bite-sized training session for the operational team, because in reality, I felt like maybe people didn't have the time to go into the procurement training intranet site and read through the material. Different people learn in different ways, right? So some of us like to read and figure it out ourselves. Some of us like to watch a lecture or a video. Some of us want to attend in-person training exercises. So the procurement team, they gave us the seal of approval. It's like, fine, Rosina, you know, go ahead and put this forward. They were happy with the material that I was pushing forward, and I think, yeah, that's it. You know, sometimes people are like, you know, that's not my job, that's somebody else's job. But, you know, you take the initiative, you know, because it's worth it. It's really, really worth it. It's worth it for the ops team. And you know, what else can I say?
And I think I'll probably add to that. I think there's always going to be challenges around sometimes if you've procured out a service, etc., and trying to get the most out of training. I think if you identify something that your organization needs and it's going to improve the financial sustainability, it's sort of a win-win. And sometimes, you know, you might want to take it upon yourself, but also there'll be people in your trust who raise requisitions all the time, who do this for, in nicer sense, finance don't raise that many requisitions, if any, and therefore you can try and leverage some of the knowledge that they potentially have and just create into like a package so that other people can sort of utilize it, rather than sometimes one person might create one requisition a year and definitely do it wrong because they're doing it a one-off period. But if someone does it regularly and then you can provide a training to, then it makes it a lot easier. But yeah, I mean, if you can, you know, use your sort of SLA to try and drive some extra training out of it, and maybe when you renew your SLA, you can try and make sure they create something more visual, and good on you. But yeah, sometimes you've got your hands tied and then it's what else you can do, really. I'll move on to, does that answer your question, by the way?
Yes, thank you.
Perfect, thank you. Amir, is it that?
Thank you. Great presentation. Really found it really interesting. At the start of the presentation, you mentioned kind of like how the uproar for budget hard training and so forth was very low, morale was quite low within divisions and so forth. And then you kind of did all these steps to bring it back into line. And just wanted to see what kind of uptake and what kind of review feedback are you getting now as a result of the changes you've made?
To give that to you, Howard?
Yes. So when we've run a couple of these sessions, and they were really well attended, like 25 plus people attended, and they were telling other people about how kind of informative it was. And what also kind of helped is that, but it's an ongoing thing, so it needs constant kind of communication too. So, you know, when the first lot of training was done, it was mentioned in our team brief about there's this training that's available, there's a, you know, there's a case study. And so it was kind of sold right from the top. So that needs to be kind of ongoing. But the budget managers that have attended, they did find it useful, because it's quite interactive. Only from that perspective is that it's not just, you know, like the presenter just talking the whole time. It's, you know, because budget managers have their own unique kind of questions and their own kind of knowledge gaps. So it's, you know, when you're face to face in a room full of, you know, like colleagues, you're getting to ask those questions. So from that perspective, I think it was, they found it kind of really helpful. And like Canucks was recommending his colleagues go on this course because he found it really, really helpful. So, yeah, so we've had, you know, good uptake. But it's a constant battle, because even when we spoke to Claire Fox at Lewisham, like, they've done the video, but you can't just stop at doing a video. You have to constantly keep communicating and saying, look, this is here. Come and use it, you know, and that's what needs to happen.
And just building on that, Howard, I think you've also got a little bit of a stick methodology where it's part of their appraisals as well now, that they have to do the budget audit training or something along those lines.
That's where we'd like to take it. And that's sort of constantly the question we keep getting. But at the moment, it's not kind of enforced. It is on Phoenix. So if you do the training, it's within your own record that you've done it. So that's kind of good. But I do think that the next steps would be maybe a certificate or some part of CPD, or, you know, other people have mentioned you can't requisition or be an authorized signatory unless you attend the training course. And those are the next kind of steps that we're kind of thinking that maybe that's the way you could kind of enforce some of this, because that's the kind of questions we keep getting, that why can't we force people to go on this training? At the moment, it's come, you know, like, it's more of a carrot rather than a stick kind of approach, but who knows in the future.
If I could add, we also are adding it to our budget statements that we send out every month, you know, as a link to the training. So people, when you go around, they do ask you, you know, how can we get on board of this? How can we get more people to engage in this? But it's not mandatory in Phoenix, otherwise there'd be just far too many people wanting to this. It's at their discretion at the moment.
Yeah. And just for clarification, Phoenix is our like online HR sort of tool. So it does all our training for us. So we don't use the ESR, for instance, we use Phoenix, but... Perfect. Thank you. Richard.
Hiya, and many thanks for your time and going through that presentation. It's great. And for me, it's perfect time, because we're just about to launch our own training program to our organisation. So I can, like I say, steal or copy with pride, as how you described it. So thank you. I guess a couple of things we were sort of discussing our own organisation is, and one of them you sort of alluded to around this, sort of make it mandatory or not make it mandatory, but also... sort of around the frequency of the training. Do you do it sort of monthly? Is it quarterly? How do you, and have you sort of set it up to be across the whole year, so that everyone can book into for the next year or 18 months or something? And I guess the other question I had was, have you aimed it, have you differentiated who attends these courses? Or is it a budget holder versus another training course could be designed slightly differently for the director of operations, for example? Or have you just got everybody come because you can't do any damage or something? And I didn't quite know. But that's sort of the things we're sort of muddling over. I didn't know. Have you thought of those processes and sort of what you concluded or what you're sort of developing on?
So in terms of the training, at the moment it's run every 2 months, and then there's two kind of training that's actually done, but it's the same training kind of program that we run. So at the moment, what Davinda showed you was the training that you can book into, but also HR run new managers training kind of sessions, and within that there's a training section. So I run this same program for the new managers too, so it's kind of being done, you know, side by side really. So at the moment it's a one-off, you know, once you've attended the training, and really it's for kind of DDOs to kind of recommend their budget managers go on this course, especially, you know, when they're getting questions that, you know, I don't understand the finances, you know. So from that perspective, there are quite a few questions that you are asking. So at the moment, the kind of where you can book in, it's every 2 months. It's not done a year in advance, it's done every 3 months. I have to book the training room, so I can book them them 3 months in advance. So, and then we see how what the uptake is and we kind of take it from there. But at the moment, I ran one course about a month or so ago, but there's two more now, one in July and one in September. And in terms of the kind of levels, at the moment, it's just capturing everything. But in terms of the training that we've done, we've also, this training wasn't actually mentioned, but there was a training session that we ran with the very senior execs. And that was led by the Director of Finance. And I was, because I'm familiar with the ClickView reports, I kind of came in to explain how to use ClickView reports. And we all did a section of that, you know, on the income side. So we ran a bespoke training session just for the execs. So that was geared totally towards them, you know, very, very high level in terms of what they would need and what they wouldn't need. So, you know, it's kind of, this is what's there. But I think as well as that, there has to be some kind of bespoke training, you know, for, so I think they were running a course, a training session for the clinicians, say the consultants, because they'll, again, they will need a very different kind of, you know, take on, you know, like where ISLR and everything will be really important for them. So, you know, I know exactly what you're saying, because you have all these various levels that pitch up on a training course. And it does, especially when with the way we run it, you know, they're, you know, managers of, you know, like Kunak, he's been an experienced budget manager for years. And then where I've got new service managers, you know, everything's new to them. So it's trying to kind of pitch against all those levels. And I think, you know, we're still on our journey. We're not at the end of it. So we're still developing, and we, you know, and we can kind of take it from there. Anything else you
want to
add, Paris?
Yeah, I was going to say, Richard, I think it's all about starting small. I think, like, you know, you could try and think that you're going to hit the moon, but just take the steps slowly and, you know, deliver the training you need to. If the execs say that actually we want a slightly different training tailored towards us, develop it. And I think it's just listening to your organizational needs and seeing what is it. There'll be key topics that are quite hot probably for your organization that won't be for our organization. And then it's maybe presenting those sort of information in whatever way, whatever format's sort of relevant for them.
Wow, that's really helpful. Thanks, guys.
Thanks. I can't see any hands up. There was some questions in the chat about sharing the exec level training, so I don't know how, if you're able to dig that out from somewhere. I'm not sure where that's saved.
We'd have to bring Bimal back first of all, because he was kind of running it. But we do, I think there is something there. But yeah, that was, it was very bespoke for our organization. It was our ClickView reports, it was our kind of, it went through our kind of finances in terms of what our challenges were and how we needed to address them. But that, but there is an overall, we could dig something out and send that out if you wanted.
It sounds like, well, sounds like a couple of people are interested already. So if you can find it, we'll try and share it out with
John.
And we'll try and share it out with some of the slides that Charlie's planning to send out. We have got some more questions. Good. I think it's Persis. So apologies if I'm saying your name wrong, Persis.
No, that's correct. My question is, because you have all these bespoke training and the ClickView and the Plix, is this training actually presented or to whoever you're presenting it to, by your finance department or by the costing team, or is it more, because I don't get it, because I thought Plix and that stuff would be more your costing teams presenting it than it being like a finance senior manager or somebody presenting it.
I could kind of answer that, only because there are training course, the one that's you've seen, it's on the intranet and, you know, everyone attends. It will talk about ISLR, but only kind of an overview. So the plan is, again, like we've spoken about. So because I run these sessions and then I'll give them an overview on, say, ISLR or, you know, efficiency. People want to know more about efficiencies and how you can make CIPs. So then at the end of the course, we say, you know, topics we haven't covered, so business cases we haven't covered, but we're kind of keen to find out what else do they want. So again, we're still on our journey and we're trying to find out from the organization what do they want. So, you know, people have kind of said, you know, we want more training on Plix or on income, business cases, that's been mentioned quite a few times. So, you know, as a department, we're thinking about how else, what else we could do to kind of, you know, like the procurement, that was something that kept being asked for, and then Rosina produced her presentation and then that was put in a video, so then that kind of answered a whole load of raft of questions. So you didn't actually have to do a course on it, the video was there. So we're thinking of our own ways of how, you know, because we are constantly being asked about all these other subjects, but at the moment it's kind of, done centrally by the FMs at the moment in terms of the kind of the generic training courses that we run. But if there are departments that want specific, you know, like my department wanted specific information on PLICs, so they ran a session for them specifically about, you know, about the various kind of aspects of it and for their areas too, because that's the other thing. Because, you know, you can do a generic training course, but sometimes people want to know about their particular area. So especially about PLICs, you know, that's profitable, that's not profitable, and what's making that up? And so it's sometimes that might be done better, like in a bespoke way with the actual service. But as I said, we're still on our journey, and, you know, and we're still thinking about how to address it. Videos, how do we do this? What is the best way?
Yeah, and just to add to that, I think one of the things we realised as well is like the budget hold training is really good and really knowledgeable, but it's also a sort of 3-hour session as well. And not many people, especially clinical colleagues, can take 3 hours off their working day to do it. So that's why we're trying to create these sort of bite-sized videos where actually if it's something that they want to understand a little bit about, rather than going through a whole training course, they maybe can watch a video, get a good understanding of it, and then ask questions afterwards. So it saves them time, it saves us time in an initial bit as well. So it kind of is like a win-win situation. And, you know, it's just helping to challenge ourselves to think slightly differently about finance, because we, you know, we can sit there in front of the computer screen and just, you know, read out budget statements, read out reports. But if we start thinking about differently about the holistic sort of how finance interacts all different parts of the organizations, it, you know, as we sort of say, if we empower the workforce to understand it, that can only mean good things, really.
Now that's good to know. Sorry, just one more question. So how do you share these videos? Do you put them on the internet, or is it just something that you save it within finance? Or
I mean, I can answer that. But we saved it on our intranet. We I don't know if we have done it yet, but we're planning to put it in our comms message as well, so that everyone can see it as an email as well, so they can click on a link. And we're planning to hopefully trying to share it as much as we can. If we can put it on the screensavers, we'll stick it there. If we can put a poster up, we'll probably put a poster up about it. But, you know, essentially just making sure that everyone knows about it, and then you can see if one person clicks on it, someone else might look over their shoulders and see the video and be like, oh, that's interesting. And, you know, just create that sort of take up. But yeah, we're trying to share it as many different places as we can, really. And as you said, we're trying to create a suite of these. So we created one, and I think the person who created the video is probably dreading that we know his new talent. So we're looking to create even more of these sort of videos, because we found them so, like, just interactive, useful, and a different way of sharing information, which seems to actually be more accessible for everyone.
Thank you so much.
Perfect. Did you use the HFMA financial sustainability assessment to guide which training to focus on? I guess how I think you might be able to answer that. So did we use the toolkit to guide what we wanted our training to be on?
Yeah, because the toolkit was very specific in terms of like what you should be addressing in terms of, say, governance, say, tone from the top. So, yeah, so the training was kind of geared to make sure we were, we were kind of addressing the issues that the toolkit was kind of raising, you know, in terms of, you know, overall financial governance within the organisation. So it kind of steered us in the kind of right direction.
So yeah, hopefully that answered your question. It helped us steer us to the right way we wanted to deliver the training and what areas we wanted to focus on. But again, we would have probably known some of the issues as well, just throughout the organisation, just through knowledge, just through informal interaction as well. I can't see any other hands up. We've got 48 people on the call, so that's amazing. So thank you all for joining. I'll give it another minute or so to see if there's any final hands that want to go up or ask any questions. Ooh, Luke is adding. There we go. Do you reassess to compare capability building? Is that us using the toolkit and reassessing where we are, or is it around something else?
Sorry, I think what I mean by that is, you know, are you, so obviously you've sent the assessment out and you've got your baseline, and then, you know, you've put people through their training, building their capabilities. Are you then reassessing to see, you know, where their scores are now, and then so on and so on?
So I think the toolkit was more our sort of internal assessment of how we felt we are as an organization, as opposed to us asking budget holders to assess where we are, which is a good question, actually, because we don't we haven't actually asked that to our budget holders, thinking how do we feel their financial acumen is and which areas they want to. I think we did the assessment ourselves because it was part of an audit requirement as well as something that we wanted to do. But it is a good question about how do we measure ourselves and how can we show that we're moving in the right direction. I think our initial bit was just building the awareness in the organization and to just make sure that finance is on everyone's agenda and that everyone is responsible for the financial sustainability of the trust. And that was the angle we're going from. I think now we've sort of passed that sort of phase one of the journey, then you're right, it's around measuring that baseline and seeing, are we sort of continuously improving, like the sort of staff survey every year? Can you show something that shows that yes, we're moving in the right direction, or no, we might not be moving in the right direction? Do we think we need to tweak the training we need to do? And I'm not, we're probably at that starting point on that journey.
Thank you so much.
Thanks. All right, I think we've got, ooh, last question. Okay, I'm going to hold this to the last question because we've got 2 minutes to go. Stuart.
Hello, managed to get in just in time there. Thank you very much for the session today. And I was just wondering if you have anything to share with the group in terms of just a, because I may have missed it, I wasn't here quite for the start, any documentation or sort of just a review of what we talked about today, just to go away and reflect on and whatnot after. That would be amazing.
Yeah, we with the presentation will be shared afterwards. I think the three key takeaways that I think you might have been there for was, A, we used the HFMA toolkit to just give an honest assessment of where we are, and you have to make sure you put evidence into it. So you don't really want to lie. You kind of want to actually make sure that you're true to yourself so that you know where you are. And then it's saying, well, where do you want to be? And it's creating a plan of, you know, what do you think is sort of the, what does the organization need? Where, what can you develop? What can you create? What could you potentially utilize already? And the last bit is saying, well, don't recreate the wheel. We're a massive, you know, organization, the NHS. We've got so many people working in finance, if you think about it, or just not in finance as well. But actually, you know, there's all this materials being created. How can you just utilize, and as I said at the beginning, utilize one NHS finance. It's a big community there that if you ask a question, someone will have the answer. It's sort of like Google. If you've thought about it, someone's already created it. And if not, then it's a good thing because probably, you know, you could be the start of that journey as well.
Thank you very much for your time.
Perfect. All right. I think with that, Charlie, I think with 5 seconds to go, we are finished. Anything you want to add, Charlie?
No, just a big thank you to all our speakers today for sparing the time. We really appreciate it. And for everybody attending, we appreciate your time too. And I will ensure to circulate the slides following the meeting.
Perfect. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Thank you so much for joining. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.